You don't do colleges anymore either, do you?
I don't.
It's just not a smart thing to do because those people in those colleges are, they're very, very young. You're dealing with 19-year-olds, 20-year-olds, and they're in this weird ideological bubble. Yeah. You know, there's all these fucking people that are just jammed in together in this group, and everybody's trying to stand out in weird and unique ways. And there's people that are doing it by claiming they're masculine of gender, genderqueer, and changing their name. And, wow, you're so unique. You're so amazing. And there's also people that are doing it because they're trying to buck that system. And they're becoming the Republicans on campus, and people are calling them Nazis. You know, there's a lot of fucking weirdness.
Chappelle talks about that in his special. With some woman rushed the stage, we've suffered as much as you, and he's like, hold on, you're a white woman, take it easy now. Yeah, I know you've suffered, but take it easy.
But just that thought, like, we've suffered as much as you, how does that invalidate this person's suffering? If someone's on stage talking about their suffering, the nature of your suffering is invalid. It's not relevant. You can relate to that person, not relate, but the fact that you can stop them from talking, or that you think you can stop them from talking just because you've suffered yourself as well. Right. Like, what about me? No, you're there for a fucking audience. You're an audience member. Your job is to sit down and listen. If you want to be a performer, well, you need to fucking get an act. You need to get booked at the club. Yeah. You need to become a professional. Have people come and pay to see you, and then you can express yourself. You're violating the audience versus performer rules.
I also think if people are that sensitive, they haven't really figured out what they believe in. They don't really believe in what they're saying. They just belong to a group and they like being a good foot soldier. They haven't really thought out why they're
challenged. They might have thought it out, but they've been thought out with a bunch of other people that are thinking the same things that they think.
Yeah. They felt it out. It feels right. It doesn't. It's not thought.
Well, she's going to do that on a live comedy show. She has some serious issues. Well, there's something more going on.
She rushed the stage. Yeah. That's a good point.
Like fat shaming.
Yeah,
there's another thing, fat shaming.
Yeah,
it's a very similar thing. Yeah. Like, you're not supposed to talk about people being overweight. You're not supposed to talk about people being fat. You're not supposed to discuss it as being a real health issue.
That's crazy.
You're fat shaming them.
Yeah.
You talk about reality. You talk about your friend with his bad back and his fucked up spine and has a hard time breathing and like seriously, like from the jump, right? That's just a reality.
Mm-hmm.
But the
being overweight, same thing is what you're saying.
But it's worse because it's by decisions that they've made that's allowed them to get that big. If you just decided to not eat, that is a possible answer. Now we go back to determinism.
I've tried that.
How much of your life is you're a beautiful man. Don't worry about that.
But you're fine.
We have suffered more than you, Brandon. But if you go back to, you know, what we're talking about determinism, I mean, is your life, are you right in the middle of conscious decision making that's shaping your destiny, or are you a product of all your life experiences, all of the input that you've received, your genetics?
See, it's a very dangerous scary area because I don't like taking personal responsibility away from people.
I don't like it either, but the reality about human bodies, and Rhonda Patrick was talking about this the other day, morbidly obese people have differences in their sperm that is transferred onto their children that does not exist when that person loses the weight.
Speaking of beautiful
when a person
people.
Loses the weight, all those genetic problems go away.
So
they reverse themselves.
That raises another question. If you do have a genetic propensity for whatever it might be, gambling, alcoholism, obesity, it doesn't mean as a human being you can't figure out a way to game the system so that you
don't fall victim
to it. And we have to keep that open as a possibility so that my free will counts for a lot.
No, I'm with Rhonda Patrick. Send all the fatties to another place. But was Rhonda Patrick saying that obesity is it's passed down?
Yes.
Oh, wow.
She was saying that the genes that are problematic amongst obese people, those genes, they change when the person loses the weight. So even if the person has gastric bypass surgery and they lose the weight and they get down to a normal weight where they're not obese anymore, their genes that they express and the way they transfer them to their children, they will be different.
Meaning so that their children
could be
skinny. Al Roker's fine.
I have a friend who's overweight and he has a daughter that's overweight and she's, you know, approaching teenage years.
She's thick.
And no, she's overweight.
She drinks tons
of soda and she eats tons of candy. And he's not a good friend. It's just a guy that I know. And it's weird to watch because it's like, well, I see where this is going.
Is he not educated though on nutrition?
No, no, he's not.
He's like Coca-Cola.
He's not a thinker. He doesn't. I don't know the guy well enough to. Obviously, I would never comment on. Hey, you got to treat your fucking kid better. But I see the kid and I see the thing and I just like, Jesus Christ, this kid's fucked.
Sometimes when they're happy and they're fat though, I appreciate it.
This kid's not happy. So it's not a good, it's one of those things where, you know, if you make choices and then your children see those choices and make those same choices, you know, you're responsible for passing that pattern on in some sort of a way. And sometimes people don't realize that until someone like Rhonda Patrick says it. And one of the things that Rhonda sent me was an email that she had gotten where someone sent to her this guy that was literally listening to that, eating some shitty food and put it down and decided there and then to make a change in his life. He's like, I didn't think that this was going to literally change my genes that I pass on to my children.
That's really cool.
Wow, yeah. That's cool.
See, yeah. The more you learn about stuff,
because
a lot of it's education, man. Not of your destiny, but maybe your children's destiny.
Yeah, right? Some people just don't know, man.
Well, you're literally hamstringing them from birth. If you're a fat fuck and you have these kids, sorry, fat shaming, you let it out of the gate, you know, and your children from the jump are dealing with all your poor choices, and you have to see that. That's going to punish you, man.
But a lot of it's education. A lot of people just didn't know that, you know, it used to be like high fiber, low fat diets, how you lose weight, and people couldn't lose weight. Then they were like, try not eating sugar and bread and things that spike your insulin.
Yeah, but then some people who are obese, are they saying it's maybe a mental weakness or is it a mental illness?
No, you know they're saying you're, well, it's certainly... Everyone has the ability to do things different. Like nothing's stopping you from just cutting all the bad carbs out, cutting all the refined sugar, cutting all the refined carbohydrates, eating like a very healthy diet, and then working out all the time and slowly but surely losing the weight and becoming healthy. Nothing is physically stopping you from doing that, right? So what is stopping you? Well, there's a lot of behavior patterns that people deal with. There's a lot of depression. There's addiction. Like, what are those mechanisms? And these are all things that we need to address too. You can't just say, hey man, pull yourself up by your bootstraps, because people don't know how to do it.
How do I get out of my own way?
Yeah, how do they get out of their own way? They get depressed, they feel terrible, they feel maligned by society. I don't think helping them, I don't think you can help them by saying you're fat shaming them by talking about the fact that being fat is gross.
Exactly.
It's just bad for
you. The world's going to do it anyway.
Yeah.
The world's going to do it quietly. This is my problem with the side. It's the right and the left, actually, on the fringes. They're way more interested in punishment than they are persuasion. You know, I know that we can pass lots of laws. I know we can have workplace stuff that kind of like makes everybody safer, quote unquote. It's just going to suppress behavior. It's not going to change behavior.
Yeah.
You need to figure out a way, if you're really serious about changing behavior, appeal to my heart and my mind and make it logical.
Through food.
When you teach me how to eat, the biggest issue I always find with keeping people motivated is, number one, you can get pumped up. You can go to a Tony Robbins seminar and get pumped up and really make a change. The question is, how do you keep inspired day to day? How do you stay inspired?
You know that comment about inspiration, that inspiration is like bathing. It's effective, but it has to be done regularly.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's good.
Yes.
I think community and information, these two are huge. Yeah. You have to be around like-minded people that also want to do the same thing. Yeah. That helps. When you're around fucking lazy cunts who don't want to do shit and they're always making excuses, it fucking trips you up. It's 100%, real bad. 100%. So if you have friends that are always making excuses, you gotta push them away. You gotta separate. Yes. Either tell them, hey man, this is how I feel. I feel like you're always crying about stuff and you're always thinking, woe is me, and you trip us all up. And if you don't,
negative cloud.
Yeah, you give them the opportunity to see how you see them. And if not, you got to find other people that are more motivated to improve their life. Then information. And in community and information, I also include things like this podcast. Anytime people are talking about these things, uninhibited, uninterrupted, and uncensored, where you get to see the real thoughts that they have, and then backed up by information from people like Rhonda Patrick, from scientists, from peer-reviewed studies, things that you read, you get a sense of like, oh, I'm not alone in this.
Back up. You're not in my thoughts at all.